Hey there, I'm Josh, and today I'm going to be just joshing around making...
One ring to rule them all, one ring to find them, one ring to bring them all, and in the darkness, bind them.
I'm making the One Ring. Welcome back to my new series, The Lord of the Rings, Artifacts of Arda. In the first episode, I based it around the iconic moment in the prologue when Isildur took up the broken fragment of Narsil and cut the ring from Sauron's hand. Following along in the film, I'll be basing this episode on the moment that Frodo truly sees the ring for the first time, and how that kicks all the events into motion. After the prologue, we're introduced to the Shire and all the hobbits, and we see that Bilbo is planning the party for his 71st birthday.
Gandalf, my old friend, this will be a night to remember.
Now, at this point in this series, I probably would have made the no admittance except on party business sign, except I already made that in a previous project, which you can go check out right here. Apparently, at that time, I didn't know that I'd be doing this series in the future. Anyway, we're also introduced to some of our main characters here. We've got Frodo, Sam, Merry, Pippin, Gandalf, and in more of a supporting role, Bilbo. After the party and Bilbo's sudden disappearance, we see Frodo and Gandalf back at Bag End. Gandalf suspects that Bilbo's ring is more than what it seems, so he has Frodo hide it while he sets out to investigate its origins.
Keep it secret. Keep it safe.
Later, he returns and casts the ring into the fire. He retrieves it and gives it to Frodo, where upon inspection, it is revealed that Gandalf's suspicions are correct. This is the One Ring of Sauron, the Dark Lord of Mordor. As Frodo gazes upon it, the flame has revealed the Black Tongue of Mordor, an inscription on the ring which reads,
"One ring to rule them all, one ring to find them, one ring to bring them all, and in the darkness, bind them."
This moment is the inspiration for this project. And even though I'll be making the ring out of wood, I want to do it justice by making it look real, by making the inscription, and by making it glow somehow. I've got my work cut out for me, so let's get to it. Just like I did with Narsil, I'll be making the ring out of basswood. I used the hole saw to trace out four blanks, so I have a couple extras in case I have issues. I installed the hole saw in the drill press, and I recessed the inner drill bit so that it'll just start to make a pilot hole for the next step. I cut out the blanks from the stock and used a small screwdriver to retrieve each one from the inside of the hole saw. Next, I chose the Forstner bit that is roughly the same size and diameter as my finger and installed it in the drill press. I used a pair of channel locks to hold the blank into place, and using the previously drilled pilot hole, I drilled out the middle of the ring. I drilled it almost the whole way through and then flipped it over and finished it to avoid any tear out. It was a good idea to make some extra blanks because one got completely destroyed during this step and another one was unusable because the drill bit had some drift to it. I took both blanks to the belt sander to smooth them up and get them closer to my desired size. Once that was done, I secured the blank in a clamp and used a rotary carver with a drum sander to smooth out the inside of the ring. Next, I installed a bolt into the chuck of the drill press. You'll see why here in a moment. I then wrapped a few layers of electrical tape around the head of the bolt. This taped up bolt head is going to mimic my finger. It'll hold the ring steady so when I turn on the drill, I'll be able to shape it using sandpaper and whatnot. I'll admit, it's not the most elegant solution, but this worked out really, really well for me. I moved through different grits of sandpaper and adjusted my approach until I achieved my desired shape. I then switched to some ultra-fine steel wool to further refine and smooth down the ring. Once that was done, I attached some of that steel wool to a bit in the rotary carver and smoothed out the inside of the ring. Next, I got started on the inscription, also known as my least favorite part of this project. I printed out the inscription in a couple different sizes and chose the one that fit the best. I got the inscription all cut up into smaller pieces and then glued each piece to the ring. I was very careful to ensure equal spacing between each phrase of the inscription. To engrave the inscription, I tossed around a couple ideas, maybe using wood carving chisels or the rotary carver, but ultimately I decided to purchase and use this little wood burning kit. which turned out to work really well. The kit has a nice little assortment of tips to use, and the burner has an adjustable temperature, which is great. Just like anything, it took a little bit of trial and error before I got a good method down. At one point, I attempted to use a pen to trace out all the scripting, and then remove the paper and use a piece of pencil lead to highlight all the embossing. This worked well enough, but it still took just as long to burn in the inscription. Even though this step in the process was tedious and a bit aggravating, I was still quite happy with the results so far. Next, I got out some shoe polish and coated the entire ring. Although, in retrospect, for the life of me, I don't know why I did this step. I think I was hoping that the shoe polish would keep the scripting dark black, but it was already black because it was burnt. So, long story short, sometimes I'm just kind of a moron. Anyway, moving on. For my first attempt at painting, I used some metallic gold tester's model paint, which would have worked really well if I was wanting to make this thing look like an old antique piece of crap, but I wasn't. So I used some metallic gold spray paint for my second attempt. Next, I used a fine tip brush to paint some black shoe polish into the inscription. The reason for this was twofold. First, I was hoping that it would keep the inscription dark, but also that it would act as a bonding agent for this glow powder. This phosphorescent glow powder is usually mixed with resin or epoxy for assorted art projects, but I was hoping it would work for my application as well. This stuff's pretty cool, and I bought both it and my little UV activator flashlight on Amazon. The light is actually meant to be used to detect pet urine stains, but I'm not using it for that, cause yuck. Anyway, next, I channeled my inner drug dealer and began to sprinkle some of that magical white powder onto the ring. I pushed it into all of the inscription and then used a soft cloth to wipe away all of the excess. It was at this point that I initially thought that I was done. I was satisfied with the results, but I wasn't thrilled. So I decided to redo it. I sanded away all the paint and used the wood burner to completely redo the inscription. This time for the paint, I first applied a thin coat of gray primer. I then applied a thin coat of gloss white. Once that was dry, I sprayed on a thin coat of metallic silver. And finally, after the silver was dry, I once again used that same metallic gold that I had used earlier. You might be wondering why I used so many layers here, but after a lot of trial and error, this is the best method that I could come up with. The ring looks extra smooth, and the silver base coat really helps the luster to shine through the gold. Now, for our glowing inscription, I'm making a compound using some clear Elmer's glue, some glow powder, and some shoe polish. The shoe polish is once again to make it look a little darker. In addition, I threw in some silver pigment powder. I added a bit more glow powder and thinned it out using a couple drops of water. Once I was happy with the mixture, I used a fine tip brush to paint it into the inscription. I performed this step as carefully as possible, only wanting the glow mixture to be in the inscription itself. And anywhere that ended up a little sloppy was easily taken care of with a damp Q-tip. I didn't film it, but after this step was complete, I coated the entire ring with a clear gloss varnish to protect it, and then this replica of the One Ring was complete. I love how this ring looks. It actually far surpassed my expectations, though not initially. Even though that first iteration was passable, I think it was absolutely necessary to almost completely redo it, because changing up the process of how I did a few things really made a difference. Despite the fact that burning in that tiny inscription all the way around the ring was a huge pain in the butt, I think the result speaks for itself. My favorite part of this ring, though, is the fact that it glows. And even though the effect is rather fleeting, I still think it looks really cool. Overall, I had a lot of fun working on this project. I'm thrilled with the results, and I think that this is a worthy addition to my growing collection of Lord of the Rings replicas. You know, believe it or not, that was a difficult project. In fact, it's kind of like what Boromir says. Strange fate that we must suffer so much frustration and rage over so small a thing. You know, on paper, it seemed like such a simple project idea. Cut a piece of wood into a ring, carve it, and then paint it, and you're done. Wasn't really considering all the countless hours I'd be sitting there like this with my wood burner, or that I couldn't get the finish just right. But it all worked out in the end, because I'm beyond impressed with the results. I absolutely love how this ring turned out. But what do you guys think? please let me know in the comments below. And if you enjoyed this video and this series so far, leave a like for me. And go ahead and share it as much as you can, because that really helps and I greatly appreciate it. That's it for this one. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next episode of The Lord of the Rings, Artifacts of Arda.